3 years now and now. So I mostly work on Microsoft technologies like MVC, ASP.NET, WebAPI, etc. And also I've been worked on a few clients in JavaScript frameworks like Angular and AngularJS. So we had a problem in our application, and today I would like to share how we solved it most commonly using GraphQL. So this is what we have for today. So we'll see the problem what we have faced in our application. At least many of us might have faced a similar kind of a problem in one or another project which we have worked on. And then we'll see like how we tend to solve this problem conventionally. And we'll see the ways, different ways of solving this problem. And we'll see like what are the drawbacks involved in this conventional method. Then we see how we resolve these drawbacks by using the GraphQL. So we solved it we overcome these drawbacks using GraphQL. And then we'll see a small demo like how we actually implemented it using .NET code. And followed by a small demo, and then we'll see followed by question and answers. So we are working on an application which does some background processing. Which doesn't have any UI or any sort of. So what we have to do is that we got a requirement that we need to export certain resources to other systems like mobile web and other clients. So traditionally, like what we do is that whenever we wanted to export certain data, we tend to use REST APIs, like where this database can be used by various other systems. And this is a suggestion we usually get from many of our peers within our teams to start writing APIs so that these APIs can be used by any of the clients by HTTP code. So this is our actually re-implement. I mean, before that, let us have a simple example, like how, let us assume that we all know about Instagram, where as a user, I can log into an Instagram. And I can have like my user details, and then I can have like a number of posts, as well as like I can have like a number of follows. To make it simple, we have on users which has the user details, and then I have like a number of posts and follows. So when we start exposing this simple model to an outside world using the APIs, so this is one of the approaches what we do. So we have here, for example, if you see, we have three APIs written. One is to get all the user details of a user, and then we have one more API where we will be fetching all the posts of a single user, likewise for the followers. So here we have three APIs. Let us assume that we have a client application or a web application where we need to display the basic user details along with the posts and followers. So to make that page work, we end up calling all these three APIs. Like we need to call a user's API to get user details, then I need to call the post and the followers to get all the post and followers details. So that's how I'll fill in the data in the web application, or else the web page. But here, the problem with the previous method is that we end up having multiple boundaries to just display the related data. So we had a three calls in the previous approach. Right? So that is one of the problems using REST API, one of the drawbacks I can say. And we can actually solve that problem using an alternative approach. So we can write a single API where I get all the users, posts and followers. So this is the response what I get when I call the user details. But here, this definitely solves the previous problem. But we have one more problem introduced here. That is that, for example, if we have a page where I need to just display the user details, I don't want to display posts and followers. So during that time, I'm actually getting the data which is not required as a client. So that is one of the problems. Here actually we are doing an overfetching. So to get posts and followers, there might be some business logic involved. It is a costly operation basically. So why do we need to get posts and followers if it's not required as a client? So this is one of the problems. So to put all those things together, we have these are the kinds of problems we have. Like we end up having multiple long trips when we have multiple APIs. And also sometimes we do overfetching and sometimes we do underfetching. So we don't need certain data sometimes, right? And the fourth one, that is clients and servers are tightly coupled, because if you see all the client applications, like mobile web or any kind of applications, those are data-driven. So because they are largely dependent on certain data, and those data is some of the other way it's a related data. And here, as a client, the client doesn't have a privilege to ask for what is required. In fact, that is tightly bound with the API, because only if you see the APIs are dictating what is the request it is accepting and what is the response it is sending back. But here, as a client, you can't actually tell out the request, you can't ask for what is required. So that is one of the important the drawbacks of RESTful API. So here, if you see, so we have to decouple it, because client and server, it should not be covered on this. There is a dependency over here. And one more thing is, like, for the simple scenario, just to have a user's post on follows, we ended up writing 3 or 4 APIs. So likewise, imagine if there is a complex, I mean, a little bit larger application, to add all the features, how many endpoints we are going to introduce. So this is one of the problems, since there will be a maintainability issues at some point of it. And even we will not be aware of like what APIs is going what, and so on. So if the clients are getting increased, we end up writing more and more APIs. So these are the drawbacks of the RESTful, the conventional way of serving. This is how I used to serve at least a few applications which I have worked. I hope that many of us might have faced a similar kind of the problems, whereas we tend to use REST APIs for almost all cases. So since the project which we have worked on is a greenfield project, we have a privilege at least to suggest some new technologies. So what we tried is, before even going for RESTful, then we started looking into alternatives. That is there something which solves all these drawbacks. So interestingly, we found something called like GraphQL. So it is developed by Facebook in the year 2012, and they have released it publicly in the year 2015. Since it is just a specification, so any language can implement this GraphQL. So interestingly, we found that many of the major languages, at least the popular languages, they have implemented this GraphQL. And also we found something like this GraphQL DotNet, where they have implemented this GraphQL. So we can actually use this library to write our own implementation of GraphQL. Right? So let us see like how, before going into details about GraphQL, let us see like how this GraphQL solves the problems which we have discussed in the previous slides. That is the same thing that is an Instagram app. The users post and follows. See, for example, here we saw that we are making multiple requests on here. On the left side, that is how actually GraphQL is. That is something similar to a Stagger. I think we might be aware of Stagger. Likewise, there is a client application where we can make requests and responses. It is the client application, it's a React application, it's readily available. You can just paste some files over there, so it's not working. So here, if you see, in the query, for example, in the dashboard page, I need to display the users, posts and follows. So if you see the users, I'm interested to display only the username and email ID. And also I want just to display the title of the post. I don't want any other details of the post. So I'm composing the request based on my, as a client, based on my report. So when we call this request, this is what the output we are getting. So if you see the request and response, the response is similar to what we have sent as a request. See the request for somebody in a general terms, see the request is request something looks like a JSON without the values. And the response what we get is filled with the values. Right? So that's how actually we solve this. So here, so that's how we solve this problem. Here, one more advantage over here is there will be only one endpoint exposed. So hence it solves like multiple endpoints problem. So that is one point. And one more thing is like, for example, we talked about the other scenario where we were actually doing overfetching in this problem. So where they expose an API which actually fetches posts and followers, right? So we can solve this problem in a similar way. So we are actually hitting the same endpoint. But if you see the request, the query part on the left side, or maybe the right side from here, there we are asking for the complete user details like name, email, ID, picture. But I am not asking about posts and other things, because I don't want to display all this information. So I can ask for what is required as a class. So hence we can define the output. Here whatever you use the request will get this. So you can compose your request and you can expect the predictable response back. So likewise, actually we'll be solving almost all the problems. To summarize this, to understand GraphQL, these are the key things what we'll be doing. For example, there is a schema, types and resolvers. This is what we need, the basic things we need to know how this GraphQL actually works. For example, the schema is nothing but it's a clear contract between client and servers. Like as a client, what can I query, and all those contractual information will be as part of schema. And the types are nothing but the structure of the user. If you see the previous example, how the query has been formed. There we have queried for the user. So then the user is nothing but the type. So the entire thing what we had seen is nothing but the schema. Right? All the users, posts and all those things will be followed. They are type structure. So then so we'll be grouping all the types under schema. And then we'll talk about resolvers in the actual demo. How the running application. Any questions over here?
The queries you're saying are built as queries,
right?
Yeah. Schema is something which you define. So you can say whether you need to be relational or non-relational. So it's totally up to you to define and say that, okay, this is the data available and this is the relation I have. So it's up to the consumer to say that, okay, I want it in this relation.
Getting
it
data
back,
something is specific.
Yes.
I have
unrelated data. Yeah. So I can have like multiple queries. See, right now we have only one query to get the user. Like this, I can have other queries also. So if there is related data, we can make use of relation with, as part of this GraphQL. If it is not related, we can expose it as a simple query. So it is something that we have a root query or root of the query where you can define other queries. So here we have users, posts and followers. Right? Those things are related. Even I can have one more query where I can get all the posts. So likewise we can define it.
But for you to query, you should have all the data already, right? You're still fetching all the data. No, we don't need to, like, that's more of an implementation detail that you will be showing it in a demo how to do it.
Okay.
Yeah, like how we can actually have multiple queries. And see, essentially, though, I put it in different bits. Schemes are something which you define in your model. Whereas each type is like your repository, and resolvers are connected to the repository implementation. You just say that I want user, then you have a user repository. And you will have a post repository and follow repository. The similar thing how you do it in a normal application. But how it is fixed in is like basically done by the GraphQL.
So it is almost like a wrapper on top of existing GraphQL. Existing. So it is not tightly bound with any database or any sort.
No. Okay. REST.
Maybe park it till he shows the code.
Yeah. Mahesh, to answer your question in a shorter way, Web API is based on REST actually. That's a different spec called Web. This is a different thing called a GraphQL. The specs are different. But the concepts are almost same. Like you need a consumer to consume the data. There's a different way to consume the data.
Yeah, as part of intelligence itself, we'll come to know how if there is some error, we'll come to know there. And also there are predefined when you query something which is not supported or which is not part of a schema, we have certain formatted, like in the C-sharp we have exceptions, like this, even we'll get it in a formatted way. Some where we can actually interpret them. So that. So that is part of this specs.
There is a, like if you see the output, it comes with the data. The similar way, there is two, you will always get two outputs. One is the data, another one.
Yes.
So you get an error also.
So if there is a problem with the fetching the post, then only the post parts will have errors. The rest everything will be fetched. Like the user details will be fetched, but the post has errors, so it will be mentioned in the second part. So those things will be like, to summarize this, this is how GraphQL works. So describe your data, that is the types. For example, here we have specified project helpers, we can have users for our example. And then you ask for what you want. And then you get the predictable results. What you ask and what you get will be the same structure. So that's how GraphQL works. So, likewise, we can solve most of the problems, like even the versioning problem and all the other problems, the topics of the rest. Right now, how we are. And since it is an evolving phase, so we can be an early adopter for this if we start using this. Definitely, there are so many advantages for all this. And let me go through this demo, how we have implemented using DotNet Core and then we see other advantages. For example, I have implemented the solution for the same problem which we have discussed, the users, posts and the columns. I put the same problem. So for example, let us assume that I have already a repository which actually gets the data from the repo, or it can be anything. And right now actually we are using in-memory for the example purpose, so I have all the methods to get all the data from the DB or its in-memory. And then for example, I do have an existing model, so like posts and follows, existing data models. Right now I need to enable GraphQL for this repository and these models. So as a user I should be able to query the users and the posts. Right? So let me show you like what are the packages which I need to enable GraphQL.
This is a Ruby application.
This is an experiment code, it is an
the blank solution.
Blank solution, right? Actually, you can even implement it with CD. You can expose a single API, and within that API, if you are able to interpret the request, whatever we are getting, and we can actually make it graphical. We can expose a single API out of it. So what I have used is, I have used a middleware for this, which interprets all the graphical requests and responses. See here, this is a library which is a GraphQL library which has been implemented by, I'm not sure who has implemented it, but it's pretty good, it's very easy to understand as well. At least there is less documentation, but for almost all cases they have written any unit test. So if you just run the unit test, we can understand like how actually they are consuming this, how they have enabled this, and also various possibilities within GraphQL. And this is a middleware which I have used. HTTP middleware to interpret GraphQL the request. So this is what I'm using. So these are the only two extra libraries which I have used for GraphQL. Right. Let me run before going into how I have implemented this GraphQL. So I'll just run this application. Just to zoom in a little bit. See here, even the documentation, we can actually fetch everything like what is the schema or what the types available and what are the things I can query on all those things. For example, if you see here, this is a document explorer. Here you can see the root query. So here I have like, I can ask for the user, given a user ID. So once I ask for user ID, this is the types which I can query for. This is the fields which I can extract for. For example, let me just query for, there is one more thing. So for example, it is something like two different queries. One is to get all the users, and there is a welcome message. So let me try with this welcome message because I have hard-coded it with hello. So I'm querying because inside this I don't have any fields available. See, it shows that no fields are available for this because here it is a scalar type, it is a string. So now, when I run this, this is a static string which I have prepared.
So, the UI you are showing is just the default that comes with the library that is
ported. Yeah, this
like
is
Swagger, it's like Swagger but for GraphQL.
Yes, it is almost like a Swagger for GraphQL. See, and I can even query for the user, given a user ID. For example, this is the user, and so I can pass an argument. So I want to get a user with an ID 1, and I want the name of the user, and I want email ID of the user, so I can get this details. So if I change the ID, I can get the different user details as well. So for example, the problem statement what we saw is like we have even the posts and forums, right? So they can even query for posts. So I'll say like I just want the title of the post. So I don't see, even though this is an intelligence available as part of this tool, here you can see even I can have the description about the post. So if I call for this, you'll get all the posts related to this particular user. So likewise, we can compose our request for whatever the needs we have, the data which is required, and then we can query on this. So, any questions here? How we the way it works, or you have to try some different inputs or something, then we can see that. Okay. So, as we know that the repository is already in place, and the post and user model is already in place. So I have some methods to retrieve data from database, or I need to register any data store. So now, as we saw in the previous slides, for GraphQL, there should be a schema defined out there. There should be a single schema. It is almost like a database, complete database, which will be used for contract between the client and the servers, right? So we'll see like how, we can define the schema. So this is the scheme. I just created a schema named Sharp scheme. Is it visible?
Yeah.
Okay. So this is the schema which I have created. So I have used the class, the library tab, GraphQL library for this. So they have provided a class for which we need to enter. So that identifies it as schema. And there are few properties which will be available as part of the schema. That is, for example, here I am injecting a root query. So if you see in the this is the query, right? This is the root query which is available as part of this scheme, right? In the scheme, in this root query, we have two fields available, one is welcome me and user. So I'll just show you like how the implementation is. See, for example, this is the schema, and this is the root query which we have assigned as part of this frame library. So if you go into this root query, so here you can see that the query name is root query, and in the root, under root query we have two fields, right? One is the welcome me field. So first, initially I asked just for welcome if field. So see, here actually we can bind what I need to return as part of this field. So here actually I have just encoded a text. This is just the context of the request what we will be sending, and I have just encoded a text. So let me change this and we'll see like how that will be featured, that you need to get reflected, I guess. And one more field which is available is user, right? And we saw that we have passed an argument. We need to pass an user ID. So likewise, the framework, there is a support for the other, right? So here you can specify the argument. If you see this, it is available as part of this field. So here we'll be specifying the argument, and this is the argument name. And here this is the data type of the argument. So even GraphQL is like strongly typed. And Once in the query, if it finds the user, then this is the method which we will get called. So here, see, I am using the repository to get the user ID. Get the user details based on the user ID. And this is how, from the context, this is how I can get the user ID. So once we get the user ID, and this framework will automatically resolve one user type. See, for example, here, if you see here, in the repository, the output is of type user, the model. And finally, when you return this, it will get the framework will take care of converting this to a user type, because the mapping will be part of user type. If you go inside this user type, we'll see that. So here, for example, this is a user type. So here, so once we get an output from the repository, we got a user model, and then we'll be mapping those fields with the mapping the properties to a fields of this user type. Because under the user, we have user ID, name, email ID, and other things. Likewise, we'll be mapping. To get the post, see here, we'll be passing the post ID, and we'll be getting it. Likewise, it will happen for all the restructure. So we have a user type, like so, which is a type of field type. Likewise, there are so many possibilities over here. They have enabled so many options, so we can solve almost all kind of a problems using that. Sorry?
What user types?
User types?
Okay. So if you go into the post call, there is something called post.
Right? Yes.
Post will also do a query to the returns.
Yeah.
So when we do this query, does the framework, is the framework implicit enough to actually concatenate all the queries?
No. It is always multiple queries, at least at this example. But there is a package available. We tried it with Dapper. There is some package available for Dapper. We need to write some more mappers over here. Actually, it generates a single query to get all the data related data. In this case, actually, we will be hitting multiple types. One to get the user, and another one is to get a post, and then to get the followers. But with the package available, we can actually compose a single query. With all the appropriate joins required, and we can at a time we can do a 1 DB call, and it maps to it. I mean, there are possibilities over there. There are few packages which are available which are really helpful, and even the working solution is there in my GitHub for Dapper, as well as the sample solution is part of my GitHub. So I'll share you the link that both of us. So, sorry. Disadvantage. Right now, actually, this is still an evolving state. So we are yet to check the in front of like performance or how actually it performs. So we are just still evaluating those things. But the thing is that at least it is working. It gives solution to most of the problems. But still, we are evaluating few things. Like one is this security, authentication and authorization. How well it goes with that. At least we are able to solve the dynamic query generation part. We will be finally composing a single query if there are like multiple levels. So that part we are solved, but we are yet to do some research on the other areas, like authentication and other things, and performance.
But
even
with
a
little
bit of
data, you
could
really consider, like in this case, let's say I want to test the user email.
Yeah, it's possible. You can have a query which accepts a user email ID as a parameter.
Correct, then you have to change the service.
Yes.
No. Okay, so actually, this is more of a simple example which you have shown actually.
Right.
Over there, we are given the query type list, but there is something called as GraphQL.convention. So I can actually go to my user and I can just decorate it by saying that you can query by these or that. I can say by email is queryable, user ID is queryable, name is queryable, then you can actually query. See, the best example of how we can actually do a query is GitHub has changed their complete REST API to GraphQL. So we can actually see like how flexible it is with the whole previous one. No. Definitely Web API had its way of doing stuff. For example, you can achieve the same thing with hypermedia, but hypermedia is difficult to implement. So GraphQL came up with a way that you can actually implement in a much better way. It just says that, okay, I have to do this query and then you get it. So, just a evolution of how the rest will be. Like similarly, you have RDS from Oracle. They also come up with the similar thing, and There are a few other vendors coming up with a similar spec because they know that it's more like the problem statement which Sandeep mentioned previously. You started by saying that, okay, I want to build an API which will solve all the mobile platform, IoT platform and other things. But you'll end up saying that multiple queries, memory and... So there are vendors coming up with solving the problem and Facebook has come up with their. So, and we found it, it's really good actually. I'll say that's what exactly, if you see the things, you might have this model and the repository already in most of the projects. The controller is not needed actually. If you have developed your code which is not dependent on controller, then you have with that said, it's still difficult to do.
Okay.
Yeah. Not gonna say that click of a button things will happen. Like if you can follow the GraphQL.NET library, they are coming up with lot more solutions than this. There is a solution called as Prisma which came in, which you show the database to it and it will generate this GraphQL APIs for you. And you can choose like what you want to expose and how you want to expose. So that's really powerful for him.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. So any questions over here? Here actually we are using a middleware, the HTTP middleware, which actually right now in this application, so in this sample application we are interpreting all the requests which are coming and then we are making use of this middleware. But actually we can explore the single endpoint where we can, there actually we can have the library also supports where we can, which can understand this, the queries whatever we have set.
There is a single API actually, you can see over here like Insta app schema, the GraphQL option. It just gives you a URL saying that slash GraphQL slash your application name, which is what. Yeah, I'll just. Yeah, you can see here, this is the slash GraphQL is.
Slash GraphQL is a request which is sent and you have the parameters.
In short, there is a URL actually which you are hitting to get. And that URL is configurable, we just gave the default. So we just told use the default option, GraphQL HTTP options, but it's configurable. You say that your company name will get this.
And then think about
the
message.
There is a HTTP call, not a risk call. This is a spec call,
right.
So, yeah, that's it. Yeah, you will be able to debug that. That's this library.
That's your third party.
Yeah, isn't that your custom? It's not.
It's built by Facebook.
See, actually, I'm not sure whether they will be building, but Microsoft has adapted GraphQL for one of its applications. That became quite popular. Actually, there is some there's a developer tools called as Apollo and other things, which is like open source, not open source, paid version. But yeah, Microsoft has adapted Apollo for doing.
As of now, this library supports .NET Core by default, but it is available for .NET.
So, any more questions, guys? That's what. These are the advantages which we advantages of using GraphQL, which we already have discussed. So that's it we have for today, and so any other questions over the phone, please. really actually, because what are the parameters you said? So there will be a method which the reservoir method is there. They actually will be doing actual query. So GraphQL doesn't do any DB calls. Right? So if you see this example, we were actually using the repository methods. If you have the repository methods, then you can make use of that. And so it will be a single query, basically. Like how do you implement using the repository? So that is apart from GraphQL.
Sandeep actually already explained the thing. Basically, there is a package called as dapper.graphql, which allows you to query only the fields which you have asked for. Like, the question was like, will it query for all the 5 fields? Like, right now, whatever we have implemented will query for all the 5 fields, but if you use dapper is like a ORM on its way, it's a OR. So it has support for GraphQL. So it will query only the relevant fields what you ask with the joins and other things. It forms a query over.
There is another package available for common fields. So if you install that package and if you follow certain things, so it query for what you have asked for. So no, it's free to use.
More data is resource-based, again, like you can query only one resource, user, host, and followers. Whereas you can query on users, like whatever the queries, but still it didn't solve that overfetching of multiple problems.
So, that's it, I have for you. So here is a GitHub repository, which is my personal GitHub. Here we have all this project, the Dapper one, which I was speaking about, as well as this sample application. So, thank you all.